is we have lawyers in charge of the equity union instead of performers, and their money bag orchestra, and the multi-billionaire snob in front of the White House, who actually is a bagman, fall guy, protected. They're protecting his paranoia and egomania, telling him on the gunpoint, "You're the president of the next 3 years, dude. Read the teleprompter. You sure I can be presidential?" And he goes about sucking up like an energy vampire, pretending to be president. He's really dodging the IRS and thinks he's smart, and he's just reading the teleprompter. Now, JFK or Jimmy Carter put solar panels on the White House, and at 9 years still putting solar panels on homes for the homeless as a good Christian leader, and JFK was a Catholic. They had Christ in the heart as a consultant. These other guys are satanic military drone cloning diplomats destroying the planet with fossil fuels and thinking the slinkers are like drunk on the zeros on the portfolio. They need more money, honey. Oh, it's very difficult. Fossil fuels. Well, they're going to wake up mighty quick, as we all are, and already know the deal, that the situation is a disaster, and they're making it because they just need to be a blob, pretending to be a representative of us, when in reality they're just, as we know, millionaires. Billionaires. Multi-billionaires. So ridiculous. Anyway, thank you, Ron, for videotaping, and Michelle, and we got a few tech directors in the audience, and you for tuning in. Now, guess what? I have before me a wonderful man named Tom Mountainhouse, and his story is amazing. And it's not that amazing, because I know the story too. I'm a writer, I'm a screenwriter. I've always been very afraid of Hollywood and the predatory atmosphere. I won Best Screen Comedy Screenplay in 1992 at World Fest Houston out of 3,500 entries.
Wow.
Authority versus Majority. I staged twice on about the CIA implanting dictatorships and a black comedy about an out-of-control dictator who thinks he's slick and getting new torture gadgets, and a comedy on this whole nasty stuff. Then Oliver Stone made a good documentary film about the history of the CIA actually destroying the authentic democracy and creating these dictatorships to suck the country dry of its money, you know. Was that guy who wrote An Economic Hitman? Have you heard of him? There was a CIA, Philip Agee, I think his name was. Anyway, Tom, what's your story? I'd like to know, because it's sort of an interesting one.
Yeah, well, before I had the hair, I was at Pat Robertson's religious organization.
At
Pat Robertson's organization, the 700 Club.
Pat Robertson, that pseudo-Christian money-maker.
I actually was being cast by him to be the face of the Christian Coalition. I was to be the Ralph Reed. I had the dimples, the blonde hair, and they thought I was their boy. And so I was going to school, a student, and got recruited. They told me, "You're going to be Pat Robertson's right-hand man. You're going to be his face and all that stuff, believe it or not." So it's like a Forrest Gump life I've led. And next thing I know, I caught the interest of an associate dean. You can imagine the firestorm on this one. An associate dean decided he liked me a lot, so he asked me to go to D.C. with him.
Ooh, with other professors.
So he asked me to go with professors to Washington, D.C. to work on his Opus Magnus, which was all these little blurbs about communication journals, right? And he's going to put it together, and it was already done at the Library of Congress. They already did it.
So does Pat Robertson have as much pedophilia and little boy
thing you hear about in Hollywood is the same thing that goes on at Robertson's organization.
No, Hollywood is now that we're bloodthirsty and kidnapping and some satanic stuff.
Well,
like in the Pentagon, they're bloodthirsty and trigger happy. Well, fools are nuts.
I was taken on this trip. I was told by the professors. It wasn't. There was only me. I said I was giving keys to this RV home that this Dr. Silva had. And he's like, you know, other professors are going to come. No showed up. And he said, oh, it's just going to be me. And he takes me up to this Cherry Hill camping site for motorhomes, and the show began. He didn't want to work on his manuscript. He just wanted to play. And so he tells me all about Pat Robertson being gay, and that if I say anything, I'll be going down.
Well, meaning disappeared.
Probably. I will go down.
You will say goodbye.
So for Matrix fans, if you want to know where the Matrix story actually comes from, it comes from my experience with the religious right. And so I thought, I'll whisper through art. They took everything away, everything. They took away my jobs, my education, everything. When, in fact, what they were offering me was a girl named Christina, a beautiful home. They're going to give me this, like, set me up. And that's what they do when they recruit you. They give you these real perks, right? You need a wife. And they'll set you up, and you'll be the face of the Christian Coalition. But since I answered the questions wrong, which one of them was, you know, the Better Business Bureau wants our records. What do you think, Tom? I said, well, if we have nothing to hide, just give it to them. Wrong answer. The right answer they want at that organization is that we answer to God, not to government.
But wait a second. Aren't they part of sort of a CIA front?
Yeah, they are connected, because what happens is, I found that out when I wrote my screenplay. So when I wrote this screenplay right here, The Immortals, which is really cool, this is what I wrote to whisper through art what the plans were with that megalomaniac. And basically what he was doing was he said he was going to stage the return of Christ. And so the Matrix, if anybody's fans of the Matrix, you'll see at the end there's a scene where identical figures face off, and you see a cross on Neo's chest out like this, and the pulse, you know, the one Neo character gets hit and the palms bleed, he looks up, but that was in there. And then the one goes in the crater, the pulse wave comes out turning the earth green, and the little girl is renewed from the train station, comes up, hugs the person, points the sun. That's my ending. So I was warning about what Robertson was planning to do. So they gave it to the Wachowskis after I was brought to Long Island to pitch it to Bonaventura through Lenny Coco and the Chimes. And after I pitch it, it's given to the Wachowskis to save their career. So that's what it was. Wachowskis actually said in 1995 they failed as writers in Hollywood, and they had to literally pack their bags.
1995? Well, it stayed in here in 1998.
No, this is the third copyright. So this is the third one.
Copyright.
This one, the reason I have this in hand with a specialist and the director of the copyright office, they stepped in and helped me. Because what's interesting is, this is the third installment, or third copywriting going on, and this is from 98, before 99. So when they saw this, they're shooting in 99. When they got this, I was told, this was held on set. That's why you have a 20-foot rule that you're not out within, Wachowski's within 20 feet, Matrix fans know about.
Wait, 20 feet of the script, you're fired?
If you're in 20 feet of the Wachowski's on set, you're fired.
Because
they want to see.
What about the actors?
Well, they weren't allowed to make any suggestions either. Even the A-team actors like Keanu Reeves, all those guys will tell you that they weren't allowed to make suggestions. The first time that A-list actors weren't allowed to make suggestions. Because...
Lawrence Fishburne?
Yeah, not allowed. They said in that big interview with Barbara Walters they weren't allowed to. Now get this. What they did was, as it was explained to me by a member of the story department at Warner Brothers, they had a 600-page visual storyboard they made, which a lot of fans know about. They had that. What they did was they lifted all the images they thought were cool from this script, including the, if I just flip into anything, basically, Field of Pods is right there. The field of pods that you have, and if you go next page, one person writhing in pain as they're being revived. Well, they thought that image was cool, along with the squiddies, the jacks the neck, the little girl at the train station, all that stuff. They lift those images, like chop shopping a Porsche, and put together a storyboard, reorganizing it. Well, don't run. It doesn't run.
Container.
Yes, a whole field of them, right?
Right.
So what happens is they call my scene that they think is cool, they lift it and reorganize it and say, it's about battery power. That was a slap in my face, I'm told by the storyboard people, or story department personnel that contacted me. And what's interesting is that they lift the scenes, they disjoint it, they make it, they don't make sense anymore. That's why people don't get it. But they had this on site with this visual storyboard and thought they could make it fall together. Now I'm going to blow your mind, I think, with this next one. So you have this script titled Immortals, right? I submit it. I'm told to submit it to Bonaventura in New York in 1993. What's interesting is you see the Wachowskis do this. This is from the Copyright Office website. which you'll see there. They see assassins there, right? Assassins.
Wait a second. You like channeled or wrote this inspired.
I wrote it in screenplay form.
1992, 93. That was before they even had laptops.
That's right. I did it on a brother's word processor.
And so you were really
prophetic. Yeah, I still had the floppies. Well, what's interesting is you'll see there the Assassins is copyrighted by the Wachowskis, right?
Yeah.
But nobody copyrights the Matrix title. See, what they did was they went ahead and copyrighted the Immortals title. So here you'll see De Laurentiis, who claims they found the... You can see for yourself, and you can tell your audience. De Laurentiis right here, you see that?
So the Wachowskis' original title was the Assassins.
No. That was the film they failed on. They said that... Matrix fans know they said they had to pack their bags and leave in 95 because they failed on Assassins. They had to bring another writer in, so they wanted out of Warner Brothers. So what happens is, on this piece right here, you'll see the date right here, 1995, right?
Yeah.
Same time. De Laurentiis, what he does is, he realizes the Wachowskis may not float this, they may not qualify. So De Laurentiis, who claims he's handling the Wachowskis, copyrights the Immortals title, but no body of work, right? You can't do that. So he copyrights the Copyright Office, my title, The Immortals, that you see right there,
right.
And then subsequent titles, and puts it under Laurentiis Communications, Laurentiis Films, right? So that's what he does.
Laurentiis Films,
right, so the plan,
Pyramid Bank.
Right, so the plan, we're told, is he's going to substitute it for mine. Now look at the next entry. The next entry of the Copyright Office is my entry again, my second installment, 1996, you'll see The Immortals, right?
Yeah.
Screenplay. There is February 1996, or January 2nd, 1996, okay? Now look what they do next. Since I went and did the copyright of the Immortals title again, they move right away. April 96, what do you see? The Immortals is now switched off of DeLaurentiis Films. He gets off of it and puts it in charge of New Image Films. But that's not going to hold water.
International Nevada.
Right, so what happens is, now that's not going to allow them to steal it, right? So they do a very clever thing, which is actually kind of dumb at the same time.
It says Cyborg Cop 3 and 12 other titles.
They're covering On Demolition Man, because they borrowed me for that. Now here's the fun part, you ready? Now they do that in April 96, right? And they go, okay, we got it covered. But that's not going to work. Somebody steps in, apparently, I'm told, and says, look, if we're going to steal it, we got to make the people we're giving it to feel comfortable, safe, right? So here's the deal. Here's the real one. 1996, July. This is what? April, May, June, July. Okay, 3 months later, what they do is they correct their problem. They copyright the Immortals title again, my title, right? And they do, how many titles do you see here?
346.
Okay, why do you have 346 titles and no body of work? What you got here is...
Army of Darkness.
That's right. So Matrix fans, here you go. Here you go. You got 346 titles.
Well, now with Credit Lyonnais...
There you go.
Bank of Netherlands,
you know what these are?
It's become international money monsters.
What Frank's looking at right here is the two leading investment firms in Hollywood. Now get what they're doing. These guys are claiming ownership. The investment firms in Hollywood. This way... But I was told that a lot of studios like Sony, Disney, Warner Brothers, Film Tracks...
Well, those are also distribution now.
Right, but they all had their take on the work, see? Wachowski's wanted it really bad. They call it the Science Project, right? In fact, they're on camera saying, in an interview that a lot of fans will know, they're asked, I think it's Wired, they're asked, you know, what do you have next after Assassins? They go, well, we have Plastic Man and Carnivore, right? Plastic Man's about a guy who defecates radioactive material. Carnivore is about a guy who rich people. They're still trying to peddle those scripts, right? That's the original material. Then they say, pause, in the transcript you'll see pause, and they say, we want to be given the Science Project, all right? We want to direct the Science Project.
Hey, wait a second. We're talking about the Matrix until now there, sir. Is evidently the original author of The Matrix, and he got screwed out of Hollywood. Hello?
Yeah.
But you know, when I Googled you and this whole thing, evidently you went to court and you lost.
No, it's not like that.
Variety reported something like that.
Yeah.
I read it on the internet.
That's right. That's what they're going to say. Because what happened was they provided their own attorneys for me and their own judge. And the judge, in the order to dismiss it, what does he say? In the summary judgment, he takes a summation, the summary judgment, he says, it's not worth going into the matchups to discuss them. Well, excuse me, you're supposed to discuss the matchups. That includes Jack's the Back of the Neck, Squiddies, Zion, Identical Figures of the Crater, the train station scene, the field of pods, and he says he doesn't want to discuss them because he doesn't want to get caught. He didn't sign the order.
Mm.
So it's fraud on the court. And basically what you have here, I want to show you this too.
That's right. Not the first time court is fraudulent.
So that's what's going on. Well, here's the fun part. The fun part for Matrix fans is it just came out with Altered Carbon on Netflix. Altered Carbon is, but Netflix is partners with Mike Lang and Harvey Weinstein. And what's interesting is on Altered Carbon, the director was mentored by Joel Silver, who mentored the Wachowskis, right? So they're calling it Matrix 4, basically, in a way, and they're saying that it is about rich people in the future having immortality, and the poor are the pawns, and a man comes back from the dead to write things. That's exactly my screenplay. So they're ripping off completely, right?
Well, wait a second, this is the original puppet you wrote in 1993?
That's right. Joel Silver, if fans look, Joel Silver actually says in 2003 they do the Animatrix and in second installment and third installment of the Matrix. He says, we hope we used up the rest of the story. We hope it'll tie together. Well, if you're a multi-million-dollar company and you're writers, you'll know if it ties together. But see, they shot it off the script and the storyboard.
No, again, time out. Every writer knows that now, especially by the time the actor, cinematographer, director throws in their creative genius, they throw their arms up and they say, this was not the film I wrote. It's very typical.
No, but the Wachowskis wouldn't allow anybody to do it. They wouldn't allow anybody to claim.
And now let's just give a nice summary of the story of the Matrix and how it resolves. Because a lot of people I talk, they scratch their head and say, well, I don't know, it's a little confusing. Well, and they made it on that way on purpose, right?
Well, let me tell fans or people that are watching, if they go to MatrixRedeemed.com, MatrixRedeemed.com, you'll see the original script that we just hold up there. And you'll see 190 matchups. It's all there. And it will make sense. It ties together. That whole battery power thing, when they say the field of pods and they say we can't control human will and how do we control them, and the architect's babbling on, what actually you have is, in my scene with the field of pods, is the architect bringing back his top 100 on test subjects one at a time who are writhing in pain as they're being brought back. It's not about battery power. The equation involving free will, which I wrote, involves if you have an architect who's going to be immortal, the big problem he's going to face is the atrophy of his mind, not having enough intellectual stimulation. So you have agents that stir up trouble. He knows everybody's free will we're going to do, every choice we're going to make, and then that keeps him fed and stimulated. Then he replaces it with a new source of power that we don't need to remove, that Western civilization's conditioned to give glory and worship over to.
That's what's happening today, folks. Divide and conquer. So many apps, so many new upgrades, and like Facebook and all these other things, and then the Messenger and all this other stuff going left, right, and center. People are confused and diverted. It's divide and conquer. Because when we're focused on dumping Trump or whatever movement we need, eco-friendly energy versus fossil fuel industry, etc., the Me Too women's movement, Black Lives Matter, this situation, the best way that they tackle you is left, right, and center, up and down. You don't know where you're going or coming. That's what's ailing here in America. Now, right. On topic today with Tom Mildhouse, who evidently has the original script and the original idea of the Matrix that was stolen by Hollywood, right, and the Wachowski brothers, who are very creative and done a lot of wonderful, their brother and sister, because one of them is transgender.
Right. Well, they're both now.
They are filmmakers that are the darlings of Hollywood, like the Coen brothers or whoever. And they got their thing going on, and they've done some good stuff. But as far as the Matrix is concerned, there's a little bit of dubious story, not only from what you're clearly explaining, but evidently there was some black woman who won a case.
She didn't win. She didn't win. It's Sophia Stewart. She contacted
me. What's her story? I read that.
Well, here's the deal. Let me put it together in a little pie here. Because what happens is, first of all, the question about did I lose, that kind of thing, what they ruled was, they provided me my own attorney, Anthony Rankin on Maui. I'd say Warner Brothers provided me my own attorney without me knowing it. So this guy approaches me, says, I'm going to represent you, put $100,000 in, all this kind of stuff. I didn't know who this guy was. Next thing, he's like throwing our case. What he said was, you can't claim the Matrix, right? You can't claim the Matrix. You can claim Matrix the two, second and third. And then this is why the case was lost. They said, and he worked in conjunction with the other firm that represented Warner Bros., they said, you can't claim Matrix, therefore any matchups in the Matrix, you can't claim, and if you're in 2 and 3, you can't claim them. So Jocks and Neck are out, Squiddies are out, Lil Girl's out, all that's out. So how am I supposed to win? So the thing is, Matrix hasn't been claimed yet. And now with Alder Carbon, I can claim Alder Carbon, and since they're the ones that screwed me on fraud in the court, I can probably claim Matrix. And then we'll see about these matchups. So that's how they did it. They actually said, you can't claim Matrix, therefore, you can't claim the matchups in 2 and 3 that are similar to Matrix. Crazy, huh? It's crazy. But I want to show you something. Look at this here. I want to show you this. Look at this right here. I need to wrap this one up here.
Okay.
Okay, so in 1996, right, July, Dino Laurentiis has his 346 titles, right? And just the title Immortal is copyrighted, my title, but no body of work. They're going to replace it, I'm told, right? So what they do is, this is how they do it. Since these different Hollywood companies had takes on the work and different writers, they let the investment firms that claim ownership give it to them and say, don't worry about stealing it, because basically you're protected. We claimed ownership, so go do what you want with it and pick one of these titles. That's how they did it. So the people feel free to steal because the ownership's being claimed by the guys that are making money by funding them. That's how they handle it. It's so stupid and corrupt, but they're dumb to do it that way.
His lawyer's going to find their loophole.
No, but they're going to get blasted now. We have our own attorney coming. So what you got now is I want to show you something really, really cool. And what we got is I was notified by the story department, right? They told me, guys, look at this graphic right here. You can see it, right? That graphic right there is a screenshot from the original Matrix. Now, if I'll just hold this up to the camera. Right here,
wait, hold it to the other one.
Like, how's that? There you go, right? Okay, oh, this one right here, okay.
Yeah, that.
Okay, so what you see right here is, if you can see that's okay, this is the original shot, the first graphic ever put in the Matrix story, right? I'm notified by a guy at the story department who's a real, real hero. He calls me up and he says, Tom, you're being screwed, basically. Right? This is after the article first broke. The article first broke? Yeah, you got it. The article first broke. And so what they did was, he calls me. He says he wants to remain anonymous. And on this sheet, you're going to see my birthday, which is supposed to be at the time July 22nd. Back here? Okay. July 22nd. You're also going to see my dad's name, John A., as Neo's dad. You're going to see my name, Thomas A., as Neo. And you're going to see my high school, Central West High, as Neo's high school. It's all on here. And then you're going to see Michelle McGahey, the art director, listed as Neo's mom. And Owen Patterson, the production manager, listed as the other school. Now, that's the joke. And Suzanne Bolgin, if fans look at it, Suzanne Bolgin did an article in New Zealand, right, where she said, anything in for a split second is for the Wachowskis' entertainment only and eyes only. This is in for a split second upside down. If fans go to the Matrix scene, you'll see this. Just freeze frame this shot where they open the pamphlet.
But give me some other proof that you wrote it. Come on.
Well, that's fantastic. Later in Animatrix, they have a clock face. What they do is they have a clock face, I was told about this, in Animatrix. And what you get is, which is really cool, you get my exact birthday. Now, you can't even win the lottery this way. I mean, you can't, it's like the exact
birthday. Well, they used your birthday.
7-2-59, exact birthday, in the Animatrix. Now, what's interesting is the records that USAA Insurance was giving me, my insurance verified, in 1996 they found a record that said my birthday was July 22nd. That graphic over there from 1999 says July 22nd. This one says July 2nd because I got it right in 2003. My birthday is July 2nd, 59, one before the 60 right there. So That's really cool. Yeah, it's mind-blowing.
That's a major coincidence that might have been on purpose or on accident.
It was on purpose. I was told it was on purpose by the gentleman that contacted me.
They're just driven you or referring to you?
They're getting a leg up on Warner Brothers, first of all. See, they were angry at Warner Brothers over Assassins. They brought another writer in to finish it. They hated that. They wanted out of Warner Brothers, and they went all the way to Writers Guild of West saying, we want off this project. That's well documented online. Anybody can see that. And so what happens is they claim at that time, Joseph claims at that time when they went out and Writers Guild said, you got to stay, they claim at that time they then showed Matrix to Joel Silver. What's interesting is that's in 1995, but in 1994, Teresa Wayne from the story department says that's when Joel Silver presents Matrix without the Wachowskis. So, yeah.
And it was called The Immortals.
It's The Immortals.
And you sent that into Warner Brothers
to Bonaventure.
1993.
I have the submission letter. This is your good proof right here. James Boyd of Norfolk. Look him up. James Boyd of Norfolk. Attorney, right? Boyd and Boyd of Norfolk. He's the one that sends the original material in June 25th, 1993. They said, their attorney said, Warner Brothers' attorney said, he'll never have the file. He does. He did an affidavit. I got the full file. I got the script, story treatment, tracking number, receipt, music, character breakdown, affidavit, submission letter to 4000 Warner Brothers Lane, care of Elizabeth to Diane Bell's head of the story department. Elizabeth is Bonaventura's friend.
And you think it was offed? Shut up. And suddenly silence, like I think Kate Spade and Anthony Bourdain were suicided when the nice popular anti-Trump.
You talking about James Boyd?
I'm talking about your lawyer that submitted all this
stuff. No, he's still alive.
Oh, well, what is this business about? Why isn't he defending you now, then?
He couldn't. I was approached by Anthony Rankin on Maui when I wasn't even planning to do a suit. He says, I want to represent you, Tom. I'm a fan of The Matrix. I'm getting goosebumps. I'm going to put $100,000 in, and I'll use some of that money out of my own money to buy a copyright attorney on to do this, and I got to do this. You got to get justice. And I'm like, I haven't even planned to do a suit. Mm-hmm. But they were doing that to get control of the work. Because when he went to file after 2 years of preparation, running the clock of statues out, he then files it pro per, whatever it is, like where you're just on your own.
Pro se.
Pro se. He files it pro se on the day without telling us. He files it pro se. And he strips it, strips it of the most matching, biggest matchups.
Holy Moses.
So that's how you do it.
Now where do we stand? You came in town to New York today. We're taping on November 2nd, 2018, mm-hmm. folks. Mm-hmm. I'm FrankCraven.com. This is Tom Malthouse. You're watching What's Ailing in America. And he evidently wrote the original Matrix movies.
Right.
Now, you saw an attorney today. What's the upshot?
What's really cool is, like, he knows how Hollywood is, and he's like, you know, we got a long shot here because this Klausner guy, who was appointed by Bush and Pat Robertson's dream team, got him in, his first appointment to the courts in California, Hollywood courts, right? Mm-hmm. That's what they wanted there. They control it all there. You know?
Well, Hollywood's reeling since Harvey Weinstein bust.
Well, figure Harvey Weinstein's the partner of Mike Lang, who has my wife in bed. I'm serious. I got the email. I got the email from Mike Lang.
Your ex-wife.
My ex-wife. On my birthday, get this, on my birthday, they're after our emails. Their court guys were always after, their lawyers were after our emails. They want the emails between my wife and I because they want to take down this, all this evidence we got. And so that includes evidence being transferred. She handled the evidence a lot.
Wait a second, Mike Lang was known for producing which story? There's another one, Mike
No, that's
Lang.
A different Mike Lang. You got the Mike Lang from Miramax Films.
All right.
Southern California.
Okay.
All right, he does a lot of Spokane.
And one of his projects was The Matrix.
No, right now, Mike Lang is partners with Harvey and Bob Weinstein and Miramax Films. Mike Lang started at Disney with Harvey Weinstein as, his title goes like this, the executive in charge of strategy for acquiring intellectual property. There you go.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, this is a real can of worms.
So, wait a second. He's in bed with your wife?
Yeah, I got an email. I love it. All my devices have this struck. And we got an email.
The screw you left, right, and center.
I'll send you an email. There's a whole bunch of emails from him. But this is really cool. He's talking about driving around his town car and all this stuff with her and stuff. On my birthday, my little boy, who's now just turned 12, lost his mom to this guy, Mike Lang. And he's the partner with these guys who was the original architect for stealing the material. Right?
Ooh.
Isn't that crazy? So he stepped in and did the deed himself. He can have her. But the thing is that, you know, it's interesting because Mike Lang's email, this is how juicy it is. He has a picture of his multi-million dollar property, Spokane, Washington. He has his bed with a shaving kit on it. And then the blurb says, Becca, my ex-wife's name, move in with me for 60 days. Z at Zion is his address. Move in with me for 60 days, question mark. And the wife responds with a blushing, smiling icon saying, very nice, and my son and I are history.
Wow, 50 days, why not 50 years?
60 days is enough time to get all the information, steal the work, because right after that comes Altered Carbon. He's partners with Netflix, where Altered Carbon comes out on.
Oh.
If I'm smart enough to write the Matrix story, I'm smart enough to follow your trail.
So how about it? What is the Matrix in a nutshell? What is summation?
Here you go. Okay, let me give you a story. Basically, what's going on is, I'm going to talk to audiences because a lot of people talk about the balance of the equation. That's the core of the Matrix. What is the code or the balancing of the equation? Let me give it to you. The balance of the equation, they're talking about, well, people have free will. In fact, it's voted one of the worst 11 sequels of all time, if you do your homework there and look, because the architect and, well, actually the Oracle, Neo, the Smith, just babble. They just babble about what does it mean? Because keep in mind, they got the 600-page visual storyboard and the real script, and they think they could just make it work while they're paying out union wages. Okay, so what happens is, to balance the equation, they ruined it by turning that field of pods into battery power. And let me tell you, for fans out there, if you hook up cows, you get more power, and you don't worry about free will. That's how you solve that problem if they're going to go that way. If the field of pods is about bringing back the top 100 of the architect who's really in history, right? The top 100. And so on test subjects that are secondary, so you don't care what happens to them. They can writhe in pain and bleed and all that stuff, and as they do. And the balance of the equation, again, like I said, is the architect has a problem. Not so much crowd control, but more so atrophy of the mind. If you're immortal in a program, your big problem is the atrophy of the mind. You need stimulation, right?